Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. Can you really create a better mousetrap as an investor so you will have enough proverbial cheese to see you through a lifetime? Well, that's a question we try to answer every week on Wealth Track. And it turns out there are some old-fashioned solutions and there are some intriguing new ones, which we will discuss with this week's guest. Research Affiliates is one of Wealth Track's sponsors, but its chairman and founder, Rob Arnott, is considered to be one of the industry's financial thought leaders. Editor of several highly respected financial journals with more than 70 published articles, he is also an industry innovator, creating several widely used products. I asked him what led him to fundamental indexing.
Well, the genesis for this actually goes back to a friend of mine, George Kane, who used to run the Common Fund, Commingled University Endowments. And he sat on a number of state boards and was horrified in the year 2000 as he saw more and more money being pushed into the ultra-high multiple growth stocks, the Ciscos of the world, even the Pets.com of the world. These companies that had no plausible way to earn enough money in the future to justify the then current prices. And they became a larger and larger part of the portfolio only because they were so expensive. He thought there had to be a better way. Why on earth should a popularity-weighted index be a good idea? So why don't we use company size as an anchor to contra-trade, bring the growth stocks down to their economic size, take the value stocks up to their economic size, and just use that as an anchor for rebalancing? It seemed to us at the time that this is something that probably ought to work, as in probably ought to add some value. It never occurred to us how much value would be added.
Wow, so as you've written to your clients, the lost decade from 1999 from 2000 to 2010 mm-hmm. was not a lost decade at all, depending on how you had invested.
Right. And so cap weighting was one very big problem, especially in that decade, because that decade was bookended by two crises. One, the what's called the TMT bubble, the technology, media, telecom bubble, and crash. And then the 2009 financial services, industrials, consumer discretionary anti-bubble, where they were collectively priced as if they might all disappear as industries. Well, how's that going to happen? And then the snapback for the survivors. True, there were some that didn't make it, but the snapback for the survivors was so vigorous that buying in at the bottom when everyone was terrified was actually a very profitable thing to do. Fundamental index gives you an objective basis to do the uncomfortable, to trim the popular, the comfort stocks, the safe havens, the growth stocks, and to buy into whatever's most deeply out of favor.
Now, the market capitalization indexes, and a lot of our viewers, I'm sure, own market capitalization index funds.
Of course they do.
And certainly some, you know, legendary individuals in the investment sphere. Jack Bogle comes to mind,
who's one of my
founded
heroes.
Vanguard, has been a huge proponent of market cap indexes. So what's, number one, do you know how Jack Bogle feels about fundamental indexation, number one? And number two, do you think that the market capitalization is so flawed that it should actually be that it's a disservice for investors to be invested in them?
I don't think it's a disservice at all. Firstly, Jack Bogle is one of my heroes. Mm-hmm. I started Research Affiliates a few months after having dinner with him, knowing that he'd started Vanguard at roughly the age I was when we had dinner. So in many ways, he's my inspiration. Jack was a pioneer. He is absolutely right that if you're not invested at the market weight, you're making a bet relative to the market. And for me to make a bet, somebody has to be on the other side of that bet. So for me to win, there has to be a loser. Mm-hmm. Okay, who's that loser? It's a zero-sum game in terms of value add. But if you can identify who the loser is, maybe you'd have some more confidence in your ability to add value. The loser is the trend-chasing, comfort-seeking investor. Are there trend-chasing, comfort-seeking investors out there? Yes, legions of them. The market doesn't reward comfort, it rewards discomfort. One of the fascinating nuances of fundamental index is that while it has a value tilt, it makes most of its money not from the value tilt, but from contra trading against the market's constantly changing opinions. And the value tilt, while it's a little bit uncomfortable, you're investing in companies that are out of favor and are cheap, and some of them deserve to be cheap. The uncomfortable part of fundamental index is what makes the most money, and that's the trading.
You created the first global asset allocation product that makes active use of alternative markets beyond stocks, bonds, and cash. And I was, you know, reading from your website, which was launched at PIMCO initially. Mm-hmm. So an all-asset fund that is broadly diversified across all different alternative asset classes. What are the kinds of alternative asset classes that we all should be invested in, and why is it so important to be that broadly diversified?
Most investors have most of their money, the lion's share, 90%+, in mainstream stocks and mainstream bonds. If we get reflation, what happens to stocks? They get inflation passed through eventually, but the first impact is they go to lower multiples. It's bad news for stocks. What happens to bonds? The yields go up to reflect inflation. Yields up means prices down. Mainstream stocks and bonds are terrible assets in a reflationary world. We have a huge toolkit available to us, a whole array of asset classes. The notion of building your retirement home with a hammer, stocks, and only a hammer, stocks, strikes me as misguided at best. There's a whole spectrum of assets out there. You've got stocks and bonds, international stocks and bonds, emerging market stocks and bonds, and then you've got commodities, REITs, inflation-linked bonds, absolute return strategies. You've got a toolkit. People need to use it.